In the forefront has been a thought leader in the field of organizational sciences. It started with his work on the alienation, organizational learning, productivity, managing creativity, managing creative talents, and he has been the thought leader in many ways. So, for example, he in the early 80s started talking about organizational learning, which eventually became very popular. Similarly, in the 2001, 2003, I have heard him at different forums talking about social entrepreneurship. Now, social entrepreneurship has become very popular. So that is the kind of a visionary academician Professor Shukla is. His basic education is in the psychology. He did his master's and then did his PhD from IIT Kanpur in psychology. He worked in the Productivity Council of India. He worked in Administrative Science College, Administrative College of India. And then for many decades, I think slightly less than three decades, he is associated with XLRI Xavier Labor Institute in Ranchi, Labor Relations Institute in Ranchi. It is one of the leading institutions in the field of education and research, in the field of organization, human resource management, organization development field. So this is a very, very brief introduction of Professor Shukla, and I wish to invite him to start his conversation. I hope everybody is safe, doing well in their homes, and wish you very best. Wish you all, please take good care of yourself. I'm sure you must be taking good care of yourself. With these best wishes, I wish to, with great sense of joy and privilege, I am inviting Professor Shukla to start his conversation.
Thank you, Professor Pandey. Good afternoon, friends. I hope you can listen, you can hear me. Is my sound clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you. So welcome to this session, and thanks for coming. But before I start, let me make a confession. This is my first webinar, and today is the first time I'm using Zoom. So if anything goes wrong, please pardon me. What I'm going to share with you is are my learnings within last 15, 20 years when I've been involved with this field. And the learnings have been with a couple of hundred social entrepreneurs, their ventures, with whom I had chance to interact, visit their sites, fields, interview them, track their stories, listen to their stories. And the gist of that, which I'll be sharing with you in the next 40 minutes or so, is India is a hotbed of social innovations. There's a wide diversity, given the kind of myriad of problems we have, we also have myriads of solutions. So it's very difficult to put them in one single basket. And therefore, there are different manifestations of social which is what I'm going to share with you in the next 40 minutes or so. And then we'll, if we have time, we'll have some question answers sessions. So very briefly, the agenda is something like this, that very quickly share with you my definition of social entrepreneurship. I know social entrepreneurship is by and large a term in search of a definition. So if you talk to 10 different people, you will get at least 5 different definitions. So I'll share mine, which I follow. And then why it is embedded in the local, social, economic, cultural, regulatory context. And then the main chunk, which is what I'll be sharing with you, are the 5 different ways in which social entrepreneurial ventures operate, or social entrepreneurship manifests itself in Indian context. I'll share very briefly a few examples as much as the time permit. And somewhere side by side, I'll which is a fetish in the entrepreneurial field, which is the whole concept of scaling. So just like there are different manifestations of social entrepreneurship, there are also different manifestations of different types of scaling. So I'll also be sharing with, that with you. So let me start with the first part, with the working definition. A little bit of promotion of my book, but this is from a chapter of this book, which got published this year. So the working definition, essentially social entrepreneurs are entrepreneurs. One of the things which has happened in the field, in my understanding, that much more focus has gone on the social part than the entrepreneurship part. So they are entrepreneurs. The only, just like an entrepreneur is passionate about solving, cracking a problem, about a technology, about a market. Similarly, social entrepreneurs are also passionate. The only thing that they are passionate about solving a social problem. So they identify a gap, they identify a problem, they try to solve it. And just like any entrepreneurs, they develop innovative solutions for that. Innovation, if we go by the classical definitions of entrepreneurship, in whether one talks about Jean-Baptiste Say or Schumpeter or Peter Drucker, innovation is the key to entrepreneurship. And I'm emphasizing that particularly because in the current, currently any small business, any startup is called an entrepreneurial venture. But innovation has been a key to that. And lastly, that they use entrepreneurial strategies. So very quickly, what these strategies are, there's a wide literature, but two broad themes I could derive was one is this, that just like any entrepreneur, whether social or commercial or political or whichever kind of entrepreneur, they identify a niche, they identify an unserved gap, and they innovate a solution to meet the needs of those gaps. So innovation is about innovation, and by the way, innovation is not just about new products and services. Innovation may be also how to make the last mile delivery. Innovation may be finding new sources of raw material. Innovations may be new technologies. Innovations can be even new organizational forms. So it's not just, when we talk about innovation, the connotation is a new technology or new service, but innovation is much wider than that. And the second part is that they, because when we say that entrepreneurs are engines of socioeconomic growth, they create socioeconomic by unlocking the values which are there. So resources which are lying in some field, which are not, which are underutilized, unutilized, or not delivering. Just to give an example, a rural craftsman in a desert, in a rural, do embroidery some in the desert of Rajasthan. There's no value which they are able to derive from that. But when you shift that craft or link them to the markets, suddenly the value increases. Dropout in the rural area, a young guy is perhaps even a liability. But with a little bit of polishing, the same person can create greater economic values if he gets a job. So they unlock the resources, they unlock the value which is there in the. So these are the two entrepreneurial strategies, and because of this, because if you look at, there are the niche in the market, the gaps in the market are very local to a specific context, to a particular society, to a particular market. Resources which are used or not used, underutilized, are again very contextual to a particular society or a community. And that's why if we look at these three parts, the problems are local. India has certain problems which are unique to India, which may not be found elsewhere, or vice versa. Innovative solution and entrepreneurial strategies, as we discussed, and therefore they're embedded in the local context. The very meaning of entrepreneurship, that's why the perspective from India, that India has, there are a lot of things which social entrepreneurs in India share with other social entrepreneurs across the world, but there are also certain things which are very unique and which manifest themselves in variety of ways. So based on the interactions, my own learning, I could find that there are 5 different ways in which social entrepreneurs operate, or models or manifestations, whatever one may like to call it, and I'll be sharing the more details about this. But very quickly, these are the ones. There are entrepreneurs which operate, which are small, which work in a local condition, in local context, for a problem which is very unique to that local context. There are public goods providers. There are social enterprises, which is broadly the popular prototype of social entrepreneurship in the media and even a wider amount of literature. There are also social transformers, and there are ecosystem builders. So I'll go one by one with each of these, describing each of these, and then so let's look at the local change makers. And I've also mentioned some examples. So these are people I think many of us have met them or know them. These are individuals who are working in secluded, isolated, maybe a village or a small district or a slum or specific community, and which has very specific problems, and therefore they devise solutions which are useful for them. I'll just give you one example, the last one, Sebayan, which I'm sure nobody would have heard the name. Protsahan and Proto Village and the Jamke project and etc. are somewhat more known. So let me give an example. Sebayan is a small NGO in one of the islands of Sundarban. I visited them about a decade back or so. It's just like any other NGO in all other respects except one. Why it came up was because there were only 3 people from that island who ever graduated. One of them got a job in Delhi. I wanted to do something for his island, so he created this NGO. Large part of their activities are like typical NGOs, which are, you know, they get some funds from government, they do a variety of things. But there was one in particular initiative which was very unique to that context. We solved a problem which that island had, and which was generally called the Jetty Project. So what they had done was, this island was cut off from the mainland. To reach the mainland, one had to cross 3 islands, and therefore it will take about 3 to 4 hours to reach there. And therefore, local produce would never reach the the mainland, not get the full, you know, value realization. Youth or would not be able to reach, often not reach the mainland, would not get the job opportunities, etc. So what they had done was, using Shramdaan volunteer, they had created a jetty on the island, with the result that now the boats could park on the island. That 4 hours had now become 20 to 30 minutes. For every trip, they would charge 1 rupee or 2 rupee, which was very nominal, but sufficient to generate enough fund to hire 1 old person from the same island who would collect the fare and would be paid for that monthly. And there was surplus which was used for repairing the jetty twice a year. So this is a great example of a social enterprise, very small social enterprise, self-sufficient, solving a very local problem. The only thing is, 2 things. One, they didn't have resource to, or neither the aspirations to, replicate it across other island. When we asked him, why don't you do it elsewhere? He said, why should I? Let somebody else do it. The second is, apart from those islands, this model cannot be used anywhere else. And those are the kind of local change makers, that they're relatively small, they are localized. They focus on solutions which are unique to local needs. They are unique problems. Normally, these are not on the radar of either the award-giving foundations or the funders. They are so small, it's very difficult to find them. And they use local knowledge and local resources. And therefore, they are able to create solutions which meet the very specific need. But they do sometimes scale up. There are two ways in which they scale up. Sometimes what I call the scaling deep, which means they work with the same community but continue meeting successive need of the same community. It's sometimes very important, especially in India, where if you look at most social problems, they reveal themselves by layer by layer. Just to give you an example, if I want to start a venture of providing affordable quality education in primary education village, sooner or later I'll find that the dropout rate is high. If I try to probe into it, I'll find that's a livelihood issue of with the family. If I solve it, then I may find the dropout rate of the girl child is high, which may lead me to, you know, address the gender issue or even the toilet issue in the premises of the school, and so on and so forth. So, or there may be even caste issues and so on. So what these local change makers do is often to go deeper into other needs, successive needs as they emerge. The other is scaling out. So many of these public health ventures, Jamkhed project, Jansa in Maharashtra, JSS in Chhattisgarh, Ekjut in Jharkhand, Odisha, have created models of public healthcare involving the public, which have become the norm and which have been replicated. So very long time back, which Jan Swasthya Sahyog created a model of Mitanis, what they call the Mitanis, which are now called the ANMs, which were the rural health workers taken from the same community, and so on and so forth. So this is one way, in one kind of social entrepreneurship, which I learned about. The others are the public good provider. Normally, public goods, I mean, by public goods, I mean healthcare, education, water, electricity, etc., which fall into either the charity or into the domain of the government. But then there are many needs which are not part of either. So, for example, I'm sure many of you know about Goonj, who started with the collections, sorting, repairing, and distribution of clothes. And Anshu Gupta always says that out of roti, kapla, makan, there's a lot of fund for roti and there's a food, or there's a lot of fund for housing. But there's in none of the initiatives, cloth or clothes become an issue. Pratham looked at primary education, Toy Bank looked at utility or the value of toys in the growth of schools. So they have some 300 odd toy centers in Maharashtra, are catering to maybe 1 lakh, 2 lakh kids. So essentially they focus on servicing the neglected but very critical and widespread basic needs. These are not considered basic needs in the common parlance. Just to give you an example, Gyanki initiative, Gyanki Libraries, was started by a Pune-based entrepreneur called Pradeep Lokhande. It started when he went to one of the village schools, perhaps his own village, and he found school had everything except a library. Or if there are books, those books were only, you know, the textbooks. And most of us know that we got excited about reading not by reading textbooks. You know, we learned, you know, we got excited because we had Chanda Mama, we had comics, we had Enid Blyton, we had, you know, Panchatantra, we had so many other things, right? So he said, why not create a library for the school? So initially he did one by his own money, but then he felt there are so many others. Look at the innovation over there. He identified set of 180 standard books which are available on low cost, will cost 5,000 rupees. And then he asked people to donate. And what he did was that every book would contain a postcard with the address of the donor. So the child can write back to donor with a review or thanking or whatever they want. I read this book and this is what I learned, and post it. And those donors became the ambassador of Gyan Ki Library. Currently, they have, I think, close to 5,000 rural libraries, 4,000 in Maharashtra, others in, I think, 5-6 states. That has happened within the last couple of years. The other innovation which she did later on was to find out that every village has some people who have migrated to better jobs, better options, and are well-placed somewhere else. And those are the people who also studied in those very rural schools. So they started contacting those people that can you build a library for this? And that has, so now it is a self-sufficient initiative. So there is an innovation in terms of the delivery. So it's not about, just that. It's that how does one customize the product or service to the needs of the community? And there's a scale. There's a scale and sustainability. These are ventures which, quote unquote, scale out. They create a model. They create a prototype which can be replicated across different settings. So that's the other way in which they scale. The third, of course, are the very prototype of what we call social entrepreneurial venture, which are the current social enterprises. These are the most talked about. So we know about Selco, Milk Mantra is Odisha-based, similar model as Amul. But the purpose for each of these, while they are for profit, but the purpose is a social mission. The purpose is to fulfill a social need. And they seek and identify opportunities, unattended markets or unattended resources. So just to give one example, some of these are well known, but many may not be aware of this Help Us Green, which I now call Pool. This was started by two young guys from Kanpur. The opportunity which they identified was that every temple has a lot of chahava of flowers, and all those flowers go waste. But those flowers can be utilized. That's the second part of unlocking the shifting waste resource to more productive. So they started making agarbatti. They started making compost. They use the local resources, which are the slum women, they would collect. So initially it was in Kanpur, then they have gone to Varanasi, and then they have gone to, I think, Haridwar, got some funding from Tata Trust, etc. Now, this is something which all of us always saw, that these flowers are generally dumped in the river. They cause pollution. But they identified that in that an opportunity which they utilize, and they have a potential to scale up. That the same organization can enlarge the impact by becoming large. So they can scale up upstream in terms of new markets, distribution chains, etc. Upstream in terms of resources and backward integration, or in terms of downstream. One of the problems which social enterprises normally face is this problem of mission drift. Because the challenge is to balance between the social mission and the commercial viability of the venture. Especially when they try to grow up or scale up very fast, the social mission goes for a toss. And they are unable to maintain that. So there are different ways in which some of these organizations successfully manage this. For example, board plays a very major role. So if they have a diversified board where you have people who have commercial background and people who have a social concern, they do that. Human resource practices become important. So there are different ways, but mission drift is one of the challenges which they face. The fourth, which are normally, in fact, some of the articles from West, like Osborne and Lewis, it was published in Stanford Innovation Review, 2007. They don't call accept these people as social entrepreneurs. They call them social activists or transformers. But then if you look at India, many of our problems are so deep-rooted in the very structures of social institutions, regulations, cultural values, etc., that you can't solve them without changing these. So they have to be, I mean, if you look at some of these right to information, NASFI is National Association for Street Vendors of India, which finally got in 2014, they were able to bring about the Street Vendors Bill Act in Parliament, right to education, RUGMARK, I'll talk about. I don't know how, you may have heard about RUGMARK. I don't know how many people are aware that RUGMARK was an initiative by Kailash Satyarthi, who's more known about, you know, rescuing and rehabilitating the child labor in the rug industry. One thing which he also did, RUGMARK is now known by some other name, was to bring other stakeholders, the retailers, the marketeers, the producers, to create that there has to be some certification that child labor was not used. So there are different ways. Essentially, these are the right-based approaches. The focus is on social justice. And therefore, so aim is on the systemic change, which is the social institution, cultural practices, regulatory systems, etc., etc. And therefore, by nature, social transformers are ideological in nature. So there is an ideological bent. There is an activism involved. The difference from other ideological and activism is that their approach is to, if you have to change the system, you can't change the system by banging into it. You have to change the system by bringing all other stakeholders, which would include the politicians, which will include the bureaucracy, which will include the media, it will include the activists, all on the same ground. So there is they are ideologically inclined, but they have a multi-stakeholder perspective. So yes, they put pressure tactics, but then there are also a lot of white papers they create. They use the media constructively to bring the issue on in the public consciousness. For example, I mean, NASFI, National, one thing which they did was to commission a study back in, I think, 1999-2000. We studied the life of a street vendor in 7 different cities. It was not just the street vendor, it was also, you know, they also brought in the people who bought from, or who were the customers of the street vendors, highlighted the service which they are giving to the urban life. That was what this, and which was well publicized, which was published in mainstream newspapers, was sent to many, you know, MPs and MLAs, led to formation of a commission. Of course, government took its own time, 12, 13 years to come out with a bill and to change the public perception of a street vendor who were normally considered to be encroachers. So now you have the, what is it called? Street food festivals in Bombay and Delhi and some other places, where the street vendors, especially those who serve food, are brought together and people say, okay, I mean, this is what they are doing. So this is what the scaling which they do is vertically, which means bringing other stakeholders to change. I mean, it can be scaled up only when the societal norms, regulations, values, etc., undergo a change. And they institutionalize the change. So whether the person who started Right to Information, Aruna Roy, Nikhil Day, and Shankar Singh, whether they are on the scene one day or not, the Right to Education initiative will continue. There are people who would take it up. The Right to Education will continue. Redmark will continue. That's where they differ from a typical, social activist, where the whole initiative revolves around a single personality. So that institutionalizing change is an important part of their repertoire. And then there are the last category, were the ecosystem builders that I sort of came to know about this sector when the sector was, I was lucky. Professor Ashish Pandey was saying that about my previous forays into, so I've been lucky, I was there at the right time at the right place. So that was the time when social entrepreneurship was still in a nascent form, was taking some kind of a shape. The sector was taking shape, I would say. So like just like any other sector, if the sector has to grow, it has to have an ecosystem. You know, if we look at mobile telephone in India, when the sector was deregularized back in mid-late 90s, it was not just the players who were giving those service, because of which the sector grew. It also grew because suddenly there were funds which were specifically for this sector. There were advisories and consulting organizations which came up. There were institutes which came up, which would train people, because we didn't have anybody in mobile telephony. There was no professionals who were available. And there were also platforms which came up on conferences in CII, FICCI, National Chem, etc., who would do a white paper, would do a survey, feed it to government for regulatory changes, etc. So the role of ecosystem is sometimes not fully appreciated in the growth of the system. Same with the social entrepreneurial sector, that the sector grows, it requires an ecosystem build. And interestingly, most of these ecosystem builders are themselves social entrepreneurial ventures. So they also sometimes, they also started. So you have, funding supports which came, which of course impact investor. One of the first impact investors was Avishkar, Vinith Rai's venture. There were others like, which are more funding, Give India, Milab, Keto, Rande, etc., which have come up. There are also pipeline creators. There has to be a leadership. So you need talent to flow into the sector. Jagriti Yatra, for example, which I'm sure many of you would know, which is a train journey with some 400 youngsters, goes around every year. It's about 2-3 weeks, where they get to meet role models, well-known social entrepreneurs. They get mentored on the train. They work on a project. There are some 35-40 ventures which come out of those 400. About 40-50% join the sector in one way or the other. The other Pravas Change Rumor program has created many social leaders who have gone into the sector. Then, of course, you have Gandhi Fellowship. And then there are now academic programs also. For example, Tata TISS Bombay, they have a 2-year full-fledged program. There is one which I think Ambedkar University was doing, but they again revived it. So there are many other similar initiatives which are coming in. There are technical support, and so there are incubators, accelerators, etc., etc. And then, more importantly, disseminator means to bring these things out in the media, in the common knowledge. So now you have online platforms like Better India, Optimistic Citizen, there's a vertical in Your Story, Social, and for at least 8-9 years, Business Outlook used to come out an annual issue on social entrepreneurs, a good business, or sustainable business, which all covers. So some way people get to know that, you know, these are the kind of things which are happening. So yes, I mean, these are ventures which provide support to social ventures. They don't directly solve a problem, but they facilitate solving that problem. What the kind of support or the kind of value which they provide to the sector is one, that because they deal with number of different entrepreneurs and look at the practices and they do documentation, they're able to reduce the learning curve for the new entrants. So the new entrants have the benefit of learning from the good and bad deeds of the earlier entrepreneurs, which is somewhere there. What would be the right strategies? How one can, so one doesn't have to learn from the scratch. The second is they increase the efficiency of the ecosystem by connecting partnerships, connecting people, creating partnerships, innovations. People who are working in the same sector can come together, create and bring new modules, and also enable the sector to have a voice, which has not happened in this sector. There was once an initiative to create something of a kind of CII of social enterprises, but that didn't pick up for a variety of reasons. But I mean, this has happened, for example, in microfinance. So you have forums which are only for microfinance. So those kind of forums are coming. So this was what my learning was through these interactions. And these are the five different types, which, as I mentioned, this is inductive learning. There's no research methodology. This is more impressionistic. But one thing is sure, that there may be many more than these five, but there are different ways in which social entrepreneurship operates in India. So let me finish with this. Essentially, there's a principle in ecology called even systems thinking, the principle of finality, that there can be many paths to the same goal. It's also spiritualism, by the way. So thank you very much for your time and your attention. If there are any questions, any clarification, comments, I'm open for that. Thank you. And I think I'm well in time.
Thank you very much, sir, for this very informative and guiding on social entrepreneurship.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for this information and guiding on social entrepreneurship, guiding through how the various paths has emerged for social entrepreneurship.
Thank you. Any questions, clarification? May I know who? I don't know how to operate this. So maybe when you say, you also mention your name.
Hello, sir. I'm Ekta Sinha.
Rashid Mundi.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rashid.
Hello.
Hello,
sir. Sir, I would thank you for your time and the light that you have given us on the term and the construct. Sir, I would just want to know that whether social entrepreneurs are essentially a reverse innovation innovators, a concept that we look into the entrepreneurship area. Are they reverse innovators, or can we attach social entrepreneurship as the process of reverse innovation?
Can you clarify what you mean by reverse innovation?
Sir, essentially, we have seen that many of the entrepreneurial effort generally comes from developed to developing countries, where there are a lot of facilities of technology and knowledge dissemination. Okay. But when you are talking about localization and the social entrepreneurs who deal with local problems, can we call them reverse innovators, which probably not in the context of developing or developed country, but probably because they are localized? I just want to, just get into the differentiation of these two.
Okay. Well, in my understanding, I mean, I don't know whether it's reverse innovation. Entrepreneurs look for opportunity. So they borrow from wherever. So they may, if it solves a need, they may even take a technology or a solution which exists somewhere else and directly apply here.
Yeah.
Or they may use a technology, but let me just give you an example. If you look at Selco, I'm sure many of you know about Selco. Selco is in providing solar lighting solutions to marginalized communities, rural areas and slums.
Right.
Now, solar lighting is not their innovation. It existed always. The innovation was how do you make it affordable? So how do you make it affordable? Which is what Harish Andy always says, that one of the greatest learning I had was from a street vendor when he said 300 rupees a month is very expensive, but 10 rupees a day is affordable. So how do you create, they can't pay upfront for the entire system, but how can you make it where they can pay in terms of their income cycle? For a street vendor, the income cycle is daily. Maybe a farmer, the income cycle would be with every harvesting season. So those are the kind of innovations which they make.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Another question, if I may continue. Just one more. Sir, you talked about the support system, some agencies or funding which is coming. So essentially, they are just support, or do you think they can be the antecedent for somebody to start with a social venture?
See, if you're looking only at the investors and funders, many of them also provide technical support in this area.
Okay.
Some of them have also started their own incubation. So they also partner, for example, there is an incubator, they identify people from there, they handhold them. So there are different models. I mean, there's no one way, but by and large, not all, but by and large, most of the impact investors also provide technical support.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Most welcome.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful lecture. Hello, I'm Nisha.
So finally, I can see you.
can talk. Yeah. I have read about a lot about this social entrepreneurship. And I was reading something like social entrepreneurship start when market and state failed for solving some problem.
Yeah.
One thing. And another thing is social entrepreneur can't afford to be failed because they have mission.
Can't afford to be?
Failed. Because they start with some mission, they start with some social, to serve some social problem. But the recent literature again, so this is the contradiction between two things. The social entrepreneur should not be failed because they are working for the mission. So I want to clarify this thing, how social entrepreneur can't afford to be failed.
Okay. So first thing, when you said ki the gap lies in those areas which are not being attended by the market or the big business or by the government. And that's what, you know, when I said underserved market, I don't know whether you can see the slide.
Yeah.
So the first point, in India, we have, I mean, if you look at most of these examples, they are about those areas which are not being served by the, either by the government, because government does not have, you know, the reach, or by the market or the corporate, because they don't have the incentive.
Right. So
the other part about failure, I think a lot of ventures do fail.
Yes. But there is no study. Yeah, there is no study of failure of social entrepreneurs.
If you look at failure is one of the blind spots, not only in entrepreneurship, even in management field.
Right.
So, but some of the studies, let me just mention about it. Some of the studies which have been done on corporate failures, and most of them when they started, they would be some entrepreneurial venture, right?
I'm talking about social.
But I'm saying any entrepreneur, whether social or otherwise, the study shows that barely 5% of ventures survive 20 years after their inception. So most of the case studies which we use in our business schools, including mine, are those exceptional cases where we survived. And it's very difficult to track down the failures, but there are, if you look at, this is indirect data, not direct data, but with some of my friends who are in impact investing, and I asked them, you know, what is your, because you do due diligence of the plans and then you invest, how many of them do they succeed? So broadly, it differs. I mean, there are some investors who are much more savvy in terms of identifying the right venture plans. But broadly, if out of 10, there are barely one or two which are star performers. Okay. 50% of them are failures. And 3-4 are those which where they are able to recoup whatever they have invested. It is very, very broadly. So there are at least 50% failures from the investor's side in known experience. So failures are there. It's not as if they don't fail.
No, that's why I had a question. It is written that they can't afford to be failed because they are working for the mission. And when they are working for the mission, they have to solve the mission. The objective which they have taken where social, where state and market is not intervening.
Yeah.
So and again the concept of welfare.
See, the failure is not just because they were unable to identify the right opportunity. Opportunity exists.
Yeah.
Right. The failure often happens because, I mean, in case of social enterprises, sometimes there's a mission drift. Failure happens because lack of management capabilities. So failure is not just because I identified a wrong opportunity. Opportunity exists. But my model of how to address that opportunity, my solution, how to, you know, solve that problem may not be correct, or my capabilities to do that were not adequate. So failures can be due to various reasons.
Thank you, sir.
So, Professor Shukla, I was curious to know. Hello.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, Professor Jha, you are audible.
Professor Vidyanand Jha ji. Vidyanand ji, namaskar.
Namaskar. I've made sure you can't see me. So anyway.
I saw that. I can see you.
That's right. So, what I was trying to understand that in the organizations you looked at, and I understand you said it inductively. Were there any movement within these categories itself? So somebody who starts from solving a local problem gradually move towards other types, so to say, over time. Did you see that happen?
Okay. Actually, if you look at most of these organizations when they started, which are well known now, they started as a local change makers.
Mm-hmm.
So, very few organizations started at a very large scale. Most of them had looked at a problem which pinched them, which was in the local context, but then they found a solution which they can move out. So that movement has been there. There has been another movement of many organizations which had a very, very strong and robust fundraising strategy, just like you have a investment strategy. But then they have moved into social enterprise stage. Often this also happened because of change in the regulations or the direct tax laws and et cetera, et cetera. So those changes have happened.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And it was really great to listen to you.
Thank you. Thanks for joining.
Professor Shukla?
Yeah, Professor Ben.
Hello. Yeah, congratulations on such an informative talk. And greetings from Manila, Philippines.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Yes, I posted my question in the chat, but I'll read it. Because what caught me in your categories of social entrepreneurs is the category of social transformers. I find this idea really very intriguing. And I wanted to get your additional insights on the profile of such individuals. Do you have insight about the skill sets that they have to be able to engage several stakeholders and the embedded systems that they want to transform? Because I'm sure that's a very difficult aspiration. And also, do you have insight on whether they benefit from being in a particular social position or coming from a particular social background or being part of a certain network? Are these things that help social transformers? May I know what you think about the profile of social transformers?
Okay. One thing about the background, your last point, there is no, I mean, in my knowledge, people I know, there is no consistent pattern.
Interesting.
I'll just give you an example. For example, Erna Roy started the Right to Information movement. She was previously a civil servant, IAS officer. So she had contacts with many people, including the IAS Academy in Dehradun, which is where the first consultations were held. So yes, but then there are many others. For example, Arvind Singh, who started the NASFI, and he started just as a typical NGO. I mean, he doesn't have that network as such. What one does find, what one does find common across them is two things. One, invariably they are ideologically inclined. So that's the second thing was that they have this ability of, you know, standing back from the ideology and look at how they can achieve this purpose by involving others. So in that sense, they have been more open. You know, normally what happens if there's a issue where government is one of the quote unquote bad guys, then one would not like to interact with government functionaries.
That's
what happens in typical activism. But in all these cases, they actively involve the government functionaries with the basic premise that unless they are, you know, they are on board, unless they understand what these problems would not get solved.
That makes sense. Thank you so much. That makes sense.
So that's one difference which they have.
May I? Good afternoon, Professor Shukla.
Good afternoon.
Radha Sharma.
Hello, Radha.
Hello. Long time.
You're still with MDI?
yes, I'm very much at MDI. And okay. I was keen to meet you or talk to you virtually. And that's why I thought I'll join your talk.
Thank you.
Great talk, great experience. In fact, I posted a question for your consideration. I don't know if the time permits. You have got, you have studied
posted a question.
Yeah, I posted a question.
Okay.
Yeah.
For all others, I have not been able to crack this. I think there's some chat, something. I've not been able to crack. I told you, this is my first time.
I can brief you. So you have shared a number of case studies on social entrepreneurship. My question to you was that based on your experience of all these case studies, do you think you'd be able to link it with the theory of social entrepreneurship? Or does it point towards any? Because I've also been trying to study some social entrepreneurs and techno entrepreneurs. There are some established, thoughts, but I couldn't come across any theory. So I thought since you have done some research work,
there are a lot of theories.
So based on your experience, which one you would support or which one you think these lead to? Because there's a lot of debate about these.
I know. Okay. So now that will go into something very different.
Okay. Maybe we can offline.
Let me try to answer that, and this is part of the first chapter of my book, There was this great book called Structures of Scientific Revolution by Thomas Kuhn, where he talked about paradigm changes. And one of the things he said that, he was looking at science. So he said, okay, science does not, grow linear. It grows in jumps. So that's where paradigms happen.
Right.
My understanding is that at present, at least at present, it may change over a period of time. But at present, we are in that pre-paradigm shift. That's the churning. So there are different theories. That's why the definition, which if you look at these 3 points, these are pretty generic, which are part of all theories.
So you see similarities between social entrepreneurs and other entrepreneurs, except that their mission is different?
Other entrepreneurs like?
Except that their mission is different. They have social purpose. Other than that, do you think there's similarities?
Yeah, and because they are dealing with social problems, their arena of operations are also very different.
Okay. So you're still at XLRI?
Yeah. They have not thrown me out so far.
You're at Jamshedpur or Ranchi?
Yeah, Jamshedpur.
Okay.
Professor Ashish Pandey, XLRI is in Jamshedpur, XIS is in Ranchi. I'm in XLRI. Okay. You mentioned in the beginning.
Good afternoon, Professor Shukla.
Dr. Payal Kumar, how are you?
I'm very well, sir. Lovely to hear your talk. Just going on from what Professor Radha said, you know, the theory building seems to come a little bit from more from the Western scholars, whereas the actual social entrepreneurship on the ground is happening in emerging economies like India. So there's a little bit of a dichotomy there. I mean, as scholars, how do you think we can, you know, you're saying we're in the pre-paradigm stage, but how can we go further in terms of theory building?
Okay. May not be the right person to answer that because I'm not an academician in the sense. You know, if you look at currently, when we talk about theory building, most of the people work, academicians working in social entrepreneurship in India, even by in largely in other countries also, do not have their basic education in social entrepreneurship. You know, we all come from different, you know, I come from human resources, strategy, psychology, people come from economics, people come from marketing, people come from livelihood or public policy, etc., etc. So each of us have our own lenses to look at this phenomena, and therefore different definitions also. It's only recently we find that there are some people who, at least I know some young academicians who have done their fellowship or PhD in social entrepreneurship. And this is a very recent phenomenon within last 5-7 years. So maybe when their tribe increases, there may be some convergence or common understanding. And by that time, the field would also be perhaps be different, where one can make more sense out of it. Right now there are different models. So that's why I've not gone into theory building as such. I'm saying, okay, these are the 5 different ways. There are some commonalities. So there's a chapter which talks about what are the common things, but there are different manifestations of the same phenomenon. Yeah, Jerry.
Hello, Madhukar. Yeah, I had a question, particularly with regard to COVID-19 now. And the challenges that these entrepreneurs are likely to face, and are probably, knowing them and knowing you with your ear to the ground, I'm sure you have some idea of how people are thinking of responding to this when things open up.
See, right now, people I know who are social entrepreneurs or somebody connected to the field are much more on the ground doing relief work. But if you look at the venture part, for example, some of the examples like that Help Us Green pool, I don't know what will happen to them. Because, I mean, that is not just the social entrepreneur, but that will be an issue with most of the companies as well. So what their strategy would be, what supports would they have? Market will take at least about a year to come back to some semblance of normal, in my estimate. And many of the young ventures which are there, which don't have enough, you know, backing or enough padding behind them, would perhaps not be there, unfortunately. Yeah, but one never knows. I mean, most of these people I know are extremely passionate, so they'll bounce back in some way or the other. That's also likely.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So there's a question posted by Sri Gurucharan Sajdevaji. So since he posted it long back, I thought I must read it for you. and the other friends in the audience. How do we and should we apply due diligence to social entrepreneurship? Is it clear, Sasdeva ji, if you are also around? The question is how do...
Yes, you are right.
Okay, first thing
You are right. You are right, yeah.
Bhushan ji, namaskar.
Namaskar ji, how are you?
Salo baad.
Yes, more than 40 years.
More than 40 years. This seems like a old friends gathering now. Okay.
Yeah, see?
We were colleagues long time back in Bhopal. It's still in Bhopal. Due diligence, you're talking about social enterprise?
Yeah, I'm with reference to social enterprise. Yeah.
See, one due diligence, obviously, the funders and investors do. Some social enterprises, I know, not all, do ask for a third-party review of their work. Sometimes pro bono, sometimes if they have funds, then they allocate them. So that does happen. But there is no, unlike, for example, in the NGO space, we have a Credibility Alliance and others who provide a certification. As of now, in this space, there's no such agency which exists, to my knowledge. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Hi, Bhavna.
How are you? Good to be in this session. I wanted to just check in with you about your insights around the organization design. So, in your experience, social entrepreneurial organizations as compared to regular for-profit entrepreneurial organizations, is there innovation in the organization design as well? Do you think a difference in how they are structured or...
Bhavna, you'll have to speak louder. It's not very clear.
Okay. So my question was, when you compare, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. So when, in social enterprises or social entrepreneurial organizations, whichever of the five they belong to, you've mentioned that there are innovative solutions. Have you found that there are innovative organization design or any difference in core philosophy or values as well as compared to regular organizations?
Yeah, so as I mentioned in the beginning, when we're talking about this first part, that when we talk about innovation, it's not just about product and services. Innovation is also may also be in terms of designing a distribution chain which provides the last mile value. Innovation may be like as I gave the example of Selco, the how do you make affordable tying up the product with the micro financing. Innovation may also be in terms of organizational designs. So you do find, one of the very classic social venture, now we don't call it social venture, but it was a social venture, was Amul. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the entire design of Amul, the organizational design was an innovation. That how do you make the producers, small producers, the partner in the large organization. So you do find that.
Related to this is also in terms of the approach and being a part of the ecosystem, do you find that they are more collaborative than competitive, or they are equally competitive?
Yeah, there's one point which I always say that one major difference between the commercial and the social entrepreneurs, or the two fields rather, that commercial entrepreneurs have a competitive strategy. Mm. So Porter's model applies there. Social entrepreneur, because the focus is of scaling is not necessarily always scaling of the enterprise. It's scaling of the solution, scaling of the impact. And often social problems are those where there are a number of other players who can contribute. So their strategy by nature is collaborative. This is one field, one area, which is, in theory building in social entrepreneurship field, we don't have a model of collaborative strategy. So how do I find who I can partner with who have complementary skills or complementary resources? So that identification, like, you know, Porter's model says, okay, these are the five different players and how do you design your strategy to win? But how do you design your strategy to collaborate with the right partners? You know, for example, government may be my partner. And often it is. The government has a very large reach. Many of these models which they created became large scale because government took it up. You know, some program, some mission took it up. But then there has to be a model, how do I work with the government? Because government is also a political entity. So those are the things which are still lacking in the theory building, so to say. We know the problems, but we don't know whether there can be a rational way of solving it.
So I'm glad that young scholars must be finding very fruitful research questions for them to pursue, and they may find it worthwhile not only empirically but in terms of theory building as well. There are two questions which I am able to see in the chat box, and one is by Apurvaji, and another observation come question by Shambhu Prasadji. Oh. Both of them are talking about the industry association, CII equivalent kind of industry association. And since both these questions are pointing out something similar, so I'm reading it out, and then you may please take it. This would be probably the last question until, means formally we can conclude the session, and then those who want to continue the conversation, they are most welcome to, and I would love to be part of that. So the question that what Apurvaji has written is that what is stopping the formation of industry associations, CII equivalent, for social enterprises? What are some immediate benefits from this for SEs, especially considering the difference in value system from traditional entrepreneurs and probable aversion to lobbying? And Shambhu Prasadji has also pointed out the government announcement about the new social stock exchange. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether it is some activity has happened on that front, but he is, Shambhu Prasad, saying that there was an attempt to have an association called NASE or National Academy of Social Enterprises.
That's the one which I was referring to.
Yeah, but probably could not carry on. Possibly the new social stock exchange in India that is to come up can provide more space. So if your thoughts on this aspect of the association and social stock exchange, and I think this is also a fruitful area for reflection and to get hold of, to understand the things better in the Indian perspective.
Yeah, so NASE, National Association of Social Entrepreneurship, was started by actually three social entrepreneurs themselves. The idea was to create this. I think with a reason they were unable to, it didn't, you know, continue or grow, was one. Okay, first there was social enterprise, so that is one part. That it was for profit organization, which is the same with the, as far as I understand, the proposal along with the stock exchange, social stock exchange. But as far as I know. It ran into problem because lack of funding and lack of human capital. So they did hire one person to as the chief executive or executive director of that. But then, being social entrepreneurs, they themselves were busy in their own operations. So somewhere, as my understanding, whatever I could follow at that time, was there was a sort of lack of very clear-cut direction. So it didn't pick up. It lasted, I think, for about a year or so. Dr. Shambhu Prasad, you may be knowing about it more rather than me, perhaps. Is on mute, is it? Okay. Yeah, so I don't know why it is not happening. It should happen in some ways, but one is that it's a very diverse field, and so far the sectors themselves, sectors are also overlapping. So finding you know, unitary kind of body, like CII or others, they have, you know, automobile sector or mobile telephony sector and different kind of sectors. In this field, some sectors I identified where it was identified, like microfinance was very clear. So there was a body which came up. There is some convergence among different players. Over here, because the models are different, approaches are different, there are also sometimes ideological differences among them, among the social entrepreneurs themselves about the models. So that's why it may happen.
Okay, so here we can actually, we will have to conclude the session formally. But we can, those who wish to continue the conversation as such, they can continue, provided Professor Shukla has time and
availability. I think they had enough of me. No?
Will the presentation, can we access this presentation some way, or is it available somewhere? Can we access it later on? Or will you be sharing that?
I can mail it to you.
Okay.
Ashish, has it been recorded?
Yes, the session is being recorded. Yes.
Okay, so we'll at least have the video, but if you send the presentation, that'll be great. Bye, Madhukar. Thank you so much.
Okay.
I've got to go.
Hope you are coping well with
Yeah, hope you too. Yeah, we're surviving. I'm sure it's the same all over.
Yeah.
Hope we'll get over this soon.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Hello. Thanks very much to Bye-bye. All of you, you. For your okay. participation. Bye. Looking forward.
Great catching up with you, Professor Shukla.
Okay, thanks, thank you.
Messengers.
Thank you.
Thanks, madam.
Thank you, sir. See you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Harikrishna.
Yeah, please continue. Yes, please continue.
So, am I audible? I'm trying to get audible, but it's like, yeah. I think I was.
No, I can hear you, yeah.
Yeah, this is Hema Nidhi, sir. I'm sorry I'm asking this question a little late. Just want to ask you one thing. How is the CSR activities by the corporate houses can help these social entrepreneurs? Because I have seen many of the social entrepreneurs, they fail because of the investment. They don't get the investment from the investors. Can CSR activities by the corporate houses can help these startups, social startups?
It has not happened directly. They can, because initially the list which was provided, I mean, now the list has changed by then.
Okay.
I mean, within the last 2 years, much much more fund went into Swachh Bharat and now is going to PMK. So,
yeah.
But there was a list of, you know, sectors in which it can be invested. To my knowledge, most of the CSR activity was more in terms of projects. Because CSR budget is annual. Social problems are not solved annually.
Okay.
So that is one issue. And that's why, you know, often the social entrepreneurs, when they don't approach, or even when they are approached, they say, okay, my time horizon is 5 years. Because this is a problem which cannot be solved within the next 6 months. And the other thing, when CSR, the languages are different. The corporate language is different than the social sector language. So there are many more reports and submissions and all those to be submitted, for which we don't have resources. So yes, but they decide how they can...
I think there is a network issue. Maybe
they gave your boys such a hero's welcome. He got the warm and fuzzies and decided to switch sides.
Hello.
Yes.
Something changed.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, Himanji, was I able to answer your question?
Yeah, actually, I got the half of the answer, not the last of the lines that you said, because it was disconnected in between, I think so.
No, the last, I was saying that some of the CSR funds have gone into social incubators.
Okay.
So, indirectly, they are helping the sector more in terms of incubators and accelerators. So, that has happened. But the language of corporate and the language of these people are different. And so there are discussions how they can work together. I've read some article on IDR, etc. Both sides, you know, what issues they face when they deal with each other. So that is happening. So hopefully something will.
Yes, because I was talking to some of the people who are entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs, and they are running up their businesses through CSR activities of the corporates. So that's why I just asked this question, that is it a good idea to go for CSR things? That's it. So that's why
If it fits with that, fine. But sometimes I was thinking the time horizons are different. You know, for example, let's say if I'm, there are different problems. There are problems which, for example, I need some money for buying solar lanterns, which I can provide to rural people and it will help them, so on and so forth. CSR money can be very useful. Right? Because it's a very short solution in a way. Right?
So then can we include those in ecosystem builders?
I mentioned about funding. Organizations, they can be investors, funders are there.
Okay.
CSR can be one of the funders. But as I said, problems can be different. If my problem is where solution may lie, attitudinal, behavioral change, and therefore it could be 3 to 5 years. And CSR is looking for outcomes, more often outputs, within a period of 1 year, then it becomes difficult.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Great. So, thanks very much, Professor Shukla.
Thank you. Wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
And the recording will be available on the International Humanistic Management Association website. Please look out for that. And there you will get the presentation as well.
Bye, Bitty.
Thanks very much. Please stay well, stay safe, stay at home.
Thank you, all of you.
Okay.
The wishes are reciprocated. Thank you, Professor Shukla and Dr. Rajesh, for arranging this session.
Thank you. Thank you, Ekta.
Thank you so much, sir.
Bye, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, sir.
I'm ending the meeting.